Questions about that? Okay. So let's move. Let's move on. I give you a little assignment to complete this exercise. People tried it.
Yeah.
You tried it.
Yeah.
Worked.
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent. Very good. So now I wanted to move on today to discussing the last of the basic formulation level path integrals we will study in this course for a while. That's the path integral over that defines a non-abelian gauge theory. Okay, so let's start. You remember that when we were studying these abelian gauge theories, the U1 gauge theories, Maxwell theories, the theories that we studied in the last class, we allowed this theory to interact with a scalar field such that under gauge transformations, the scalar transform like phi prime is equal to phi alpha by phi alpha is function of x. That's called a lambda. And a mu went to a mu of 2z. Let's call it phi as phi. A tilde plus del alpha del mu lambda. And then the action d mu phi 1 squared plus the kinetic term for the gauge, f squared term was gauge invariant, where d mu is equal to d mu minus I a. Okay? You remember this. Now, you remember also that this trick, this is the way of producing an action of a gauge field interacting with other things. Okay? Could only work if we had a matter action which, in the absence of the gauge field, had an invariance under U1. A phase rotation invariance. Okay. Now, given this, and given the fact, as you know, that it's successfully implemented in nature, or that it is implemented in nature, in the theory of electromagnetism. By the way, phi could have been replaced by a fermionic field. The psi that we talked about last class, nothing would change. Okay, inside that path of time, nothing would change. Okay, so given that it's implemented in nature, there is a natural urge for a theorist, someone who likes speculating about generalizations and structures, to ask the following question. Suppose we had instead a matter action that was invariant under some other symmetric group. Some symmetric group that was not U1. Okay? Can we play the same game for that kind of matter action? For that kind of matter action. Can we try to devise some sort of interactions with the massless gauge field and this matter action that knows about the symmetric group of that matter action? Okay? This is a natural question to ask. It may at first seem rather unknown. It's a question that historically came almost out of nowhere. You know, when Yang asked this question, for instance, and he gave a talk at the Institute for Advanced Study, his motivation was that perhaps it couldn't describe nucleon interactions. And almost had to stop the talk in the middle because Pauli kept insisting that it made no sense because this theory just had a massless gauge field. Okay. The actual motivation for him to study, to perform this study was not really phenomenological. Because the phenomenology was forced. The real motivation is a motivation that often links to theoretical success. That is, you see a structure, you ask, you get into your semi-mathematician mode and ask, is there some natural generalization of the structure? Work out its consequences and then step after working out its consequences, look back to see if it has could possibly have a reasonable physical application. You know, this is, you know, physicists function in both ways. One guy just by phenomenology, one guy just by structure. You know, the most beautiful moments of physics happen when these two come together. We're going to try to look at some sort of matter branching that is inherent under some symmetric group that's not human. So let's step back for a minute and think about symmetries. So what is a symmetry? What's a symmetry of an action? So suppose I have some S of phi. There's a symmetry of the action is some transformation. Phi tilde is equal to, let's say, F A of phi, which leaves the form of the action unchanged. What does that mean? Okay? What this means is that if I compute S of phi tilde, then I plug this phi tilde equal to phi, F A of phi. The result is equal to S of phi. Okay? For any action, you can plug in this change of variables. Okay? But for most actions and most symmetric transformations, what you get as a function of phi will be entirely different as the function of phi tilde that you start with. Okay? When you've got some function of fields, you've got some function of fields and some symmetric transformation rule, that has this some transformation rule that has this property, we call this a symmetry of the action. Okay? We'll come back to the study of symmetries and the consequences of what identities very soon. That's where the end of this lecture. But at the moment, what we want to do is to specialize in particular kinds of symmetry. Okay? A kind of symmetry that's sometimes called a linearly realized symmetry. Okay? Where the fields, say, phi A, transform as some matrix. At the moment, all at the same point. This is a specialization and will not be the most general case, but it will be sufficient to motivate the instruction that we're interested in today. Okay? Fine. Now, any such transformation is symmetric, but in today's class info, for what we're going to do today, we're interested in what I call continuous symmetric groups. So, symmetric transformation groups that are labeled by a continuous parameter. Okay? And have the property that at some value of the parameter, this M becomes identity. So, an example would be the rotation. Okay, rotating by some angle and some axis direction. You know, you've got two continuous parameters, where the axis points, how much you rotate by. And if you rotate by angle equal to zero, you're doing nothing. That's identity. Okay? But of course, we'll be looking at internal symmetries, not space time. But just to give, that was just an example to give you the idea of what this continuous symmetry group is. Okay, so suppose I've got a class of matrices, I've got some class of matrices labeled by some number of continuous parameters, which have the properties that some values of these parameters, let's call that value of the parameter 0, convention, by convention, this matrix becomes the identity matrix. And in the neighborhood of those parameters, let me denote this matrix M by e to the power I t. In the neighborhood of identity, t is a small matrix because t is 0 when we have identity. Okay? And and I want to know what I can say about these matrices t. Okay. So, now, suppose I have the first thing to say about it is that in the neighborhood of identity, M is equal to identity plus I and T. So, there is an infinitesimal version of the symmetric transformation. The identity just does nothing. And T acts on your field phi infinitesimally. So, phi tilde is equal to phi plus I T plus phi. In the neighborhood of identity, this equation is sometimes written as delta phi is equal to I t. The change in phi due to the symmetric transformation is this object. Okay. Now, I'm interested in knowing what we can say about these matrices, what we can say about the collection of these matrices. Okay, so what can we say? Well, one thing we can say is the following. Look, suppose I act with an infinitesimal symmetry transformation. Okay? And then I act with another infinitesimal symmetry transformation. I want to know what the result is. Okay. So, what is the result? Well, you can use the Baker-Campbell-House law of identity. Okay, so this will, you would be able to write if you wanted to, as e to pi d1 plus d2, some infinitesimal symmetry transformation, times something else, and leading order that something else will be up to some number, d1 combinator d2. Okay, but suppose the set of t's is the full set of infinitesimal symmetry. This is an infinitesimal symmetry transformation compounded by something. We know that the product of two little symmetry transformations gives us a symmetry transformation. Okay? This by itself is one of these symmetry transformations. So this must be another one. Okay? So T1 commutator T2 must by itself be an infinitesimal symmetry transformation. Okay? So we label the set of all infinitesimal symmetry transformations by TA. This index A is a which transformation. We could, in the set of all symmetry transformations, we could write I times C A B C. Okay, now I'll call it F. Weinberg uses the symbol C for this. Most people use F. Since we've been using multiple textbooks, it's a bit hard to get conventions straight. Let me call it F. Times TC. Okay, is this clear? Okay, excellent.
Sir, can you just repeat the point why these two are separate symmetry?
Okay, you see, this guy gives you a symmetry. See, this guy gives you a symmetry transformation, but the whole thing does. Because this whole thing is just acting by something, by acting with something else. Look at our definition of the symmetry. It's clear that if you act once and then act again, you get a symmetry.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay? So take this inverse times this. That's also some symmetry transformation. Okay? So this must be. Is this clear?
Yeah. So would the commutator be a order T square?
Yes, it is a order T square, but it's the leading order term for this product. So suppose I take this on this side, then what you get is order t squared plus order t cubed and so on. So it's an exact statement. Suppose I wanted to do, the fact that this guy is a symmetric transformation is an exact statement. Okay, now what I've done is take the right hand side and expand it in the power, if you want, you can expand it in the power series in t. In the coefficient behind this genome. This term here is the linear term. This is the leading order term at quadratic order. Okay? So since the whole thing to all orders in T must be a symmetry transformation, we're processing that information at order T squared.
So how are we writing the commutator as linear? Are we putting any constraint on F as such?
No.
But then the commutator of our square order product is giving me a linear order.
No, but you see, what we would have, suppose I put some order alpha, suppose I put some small parameter epsilon. Okay? This would have an epsilon, and this would have an epsilon squared. These are matrices that are like have numbers that are order one. The smallness will go into this epsilon. Okay? Fine, yeah. So, right. Okay, that's a good question. So, we're going to imagine some basis in the space of what's called generators. Okay, for the set of all infinitesimal transformations, the things that you put in the exponent, let's form a basis. Okay? And then to make it near to identity, we'll make the coefficient of those basis vectors smaller. Not make matrices themselves smaller. Okay? But these TAs and TBs are some fixed bases that have no small parameter. Okay, good question. There are many ways of writing the vector calculus. One way, you could write it as T2, C1 plus T2 times something else. And that something else, its leading term, is T1 computed. So three distinct Baker Campbell house is one of which is this one. Okay? If you're not comfortable with this, you can just work it out, expand this, and work it out consistently the same. Okay, you'll find that 2 second order with some number here, this way. Is this clear? Okay, so what we concluded is that the space of infinitesimal symmetry transformations, these T's, okay, firstly, of course, clearly they form a vector space, okay, because the leading order, T1 plus T2, this has to be symmetric, the leading order, the next order, the leading order is going to be symmetric, T1 plus T2, it's obvious, okay. But secondly, we've also concluded that there's a bracket of the space of generators. This bracket is sometimes called a Lie bracket. It's a bilinear form on the space of generators, which is anti-symmetric, that maps two elements of these generators to a generator itself. Okay? Great. Now, yes?
Is there any significance to the way you put these?
About the up and down?
Yeah.
I will always follow the following index convention. I made the statement for an arbitrary basis in the space of generators. So I want the statement, whatever it is, to be invariant under a change of basis. Okay? Suppose I do a similarity transformation, a lower index will transform, let's say, like S, the upper index will transform like S plus. Okay, so I'm keeping consistent track of the transformation properties under change of basis of generators. Is this clear? Okay, excellent. Now, see, as we've explained, the symmetric transformation, at least in our context, is matrices acting on fields. Okay, so these T's are some matrices. Okay? Some finite dimensional matrices. Now, it's an obvious property of finite dimensional matrices that X cyclically summed over X, Y, and Z is 0. Why is this true? Let's check it. Okay? This is just true for matrix multiplication. Let's check it. What is this quantity? This is X into YZ minus ZY minus YZ minus ZY times X. So we write this as x, y, z minus y, z, x plus x, y, z. But I'm writing this y, z, x. I'm grouping together the way that's convenient for me. Okay? Plus z, y, x minus x, z. That's true for one of these quantities. Then they have to cyclically sum. Okay? But cyclic summation, under cyclic summation, this guy is equal to this guy. Because if I take the x from here, this is x, y, z. Okay? So these two cancel under cyclic sum. Okay? Similarly, this is equal to this under cyclic sum. Okay? For instance, I take the x there, z by x. Okay? So, just as a trivial identity for matrices,
what's it true only for finite dimensional?
Okay, it's true for any operator product that is associative. Okay? In particular, it's true for finite dimensional matrices. Okay. Now, this trivial identity that, has nothing really very much to it, has fancy names, it's called the Jacobi identity. Okay? Good deal, right? You're at A, B, A B minus B A plus A B A.
It's true.
No, I like it. Okay, so you know, there's nothing deep to this. Obvious, some statements that anyone can discover. However, for these symmetry algebras, it's very important for this class. Let's try to work out the consequence. It's true more generally for any associative product. Okay? This is a very, very elementary statement about product. The reason it's not so familiar to us is that when we grow up in school, we learn about products that are commutative. You know, order in month, number. So, this is of course true, but it's stupidly true because every term is zero. Because why commutative is zero? So, it's not so familiar in our minds because we didn't grow up as children learning. But, you know, have we lived in some? Yeah. I mean, it's about as simple as AB is equal to BA for numbers. Roughly, it's that kind of identity. Okay. Fine. But you see, even very simple facts become sometimes have very deep consequences. Okay? And that is one of those. So let's try to understand. Let's try to understand what comes. Actually, before we do that, I'm going to introduce the notion of a representation of this algebra. So, suppose we've got this abstract identity. TA commutative, TB is whatever. Any group of matrices in any Hilbert space, or any group of operators in any Hilbert space, that obey this identity are called a representation. A representation of this algebra. Okay, we will usually be interested in finite dimensional representations. So finite dimensional representations, not always, usually, at least for what I'm talking about now. Okay, so finite dimensional representations of this algebra, just some finite dimensional matrices that implement this algebra. Okay, because we know most of this, we know from study of SE2, just remind me. Okay, so now there's something about notions that go into making up this pre-algebra already supply you with one representation of the algebra. Okay? And it's this representation that I want to explain. See, suppose we've got an infinitesimal symmetry object here. And I act on it with another infinitesimal. Okay? This, as we discussed, gives me another infinitesimal element. At least to some leading audience. Right? But is it a does that generate a representation of the algebra in the sense that we have talked about? No. Okay? Because the kind of representations that we're interested in are representations in which identity acts trivially. Okay? Of course, if we look at delta t, suppose I look at the following. You could try to make what I said correct by looking not at what you get, but as that minus something else. Try to make that correct. Okay, but let me forget. Sorry, let me just erase what I was trying to say. Suppose I look at this object. So I've got an infinitesimal group M, and I act on it from the left by one guy, from the right by its inverse. Okay, what does this generate? You know, what do I get from this? Okay, now an infinitesimal order. What do I get from this? Okay, so an infinitesimal order. What you get from this? We can use beta, kappa, lambda, tau. Maybe once we should just let me see what I get at order. If I call this A and this B, so suppose I put some epsilon 1 here, epsilon 2 here. Let me take this and expand it to in orders of epsilon. I'm interested actually keeping the term of order epsilon 1. You see, the leading term in epsilon 1. The leading term in epsilon 1. And then also expand that to leading order in epsilon 2. Okay, so what do I get? So from here I'll get 1 plus epsilon 1 t 2 plus I plus I epsilon 1 by whole squared by 2 squared. Okay, from here I get 1 plus I epsilon 2 t 1 plus I epsilon 1 squared by 2. Okay, and here I get 1 minus I epsilon 1 2 minus I epsilon 1 2 squared by 2.
Sir, is there any constraint on whether epsilon should be real or not? Could we have taken a complex epsilon?
Yeah. Now, okay, good. Let me work at the moment. You see, suppose things with complex epsilons are symmetries. Okay? Then I'll break that up into two different symmetry
generators.
The real dimension. So for me, these epsilons are always going to be real. Okay? So the most general generator will be a real number times. Fine. So now, if I expand this out, first let me keep terms that are linear order in epsilon 1. Okay? The terms that are linear order in epsilon 1 are what? The terms that are linear order in epsilon 1 are this guy and this guy, but they just cancel. This simply reflects the fact that if I didn't have this, this is a symmetry generator times its inverse, so that just gives us k. Okay? The term that's linear order in epsilon 2 is simply this object itself. Okay. The term that's linear order in epsilon 2 is simply this object itself. So that's what we started with. I'm interested in the change. Okay. So the leading order in the change is proportional to one factor of this and one factor of this. If we didn't have one factor of this, there would be no change. And if we didn't have any factor of this, these two things cancel. Okay. So the leading order in that is what? It's t2 times t1. I have to take all these products. So one term is T2, T1 identity. Another term is identity, T1, T2. Okay? So you see that it is proportional, up to some numbers, to T1 commutator T1. Okay? So this action of the group on itself infinitesimally generates a linear action on the space of generators. You see, we started with some generator here. Okay? We acted on it with a symmetric transformation. And we got something proportional to what we started with. Okay? Now it's this something proportional to what we started it that wouldn't have happened if we just looked at this simple action. Because the leading term would have been T1 plus T2. So there would have been part in delta P, which is just T2 without a factor of T1. Okay? This is not a linear action of the group. It would not have come from it's not an infinitesimal version of the matrix delta, you know, phi is equal to matrix times phi. Do you understand? So the simple action from the group from the left or from the right at the infinitesimal level does not generate a representation of the group in the sense that we define it. But this combined action of the group from the left and from the right defines, at the infinitesimal level, a representation of the group. Okay? And the representation is such that T1, okay, acting on T2, is given by the commutator. So let's look at this representation in a little more detail. Okay. Suppose I had suppose I had, right, so let me write this T2 commutator T1. Switch the sign. Okay, and suppose I want to know how how TB acts on TA. Okay? Look, the logical role of these two objects in the expression I'm writing is different. This is the basis vector in the vector space that hosts the representation. This is the symmetry generator. Is this clear? Now we know what we get. We get it. By our definition, I, F, A, B, C, times B, C. Okay? This expresses the fact that we've got a linear action, because the action of the generator on a basis vector gives us a linear combination of basis vectors. Okay? Now, in general, when we've got some basis vector, say phi b, phi m, okay, and we have the expression delta phi as a column, okay, but let's say delta phi n is equal to I times t r a m n m phi m. Okay, we denote this as the representation matrices TA in the Rth representation. In a particular, R is some label for representation. Okay, this is a matrix, and we will regard this matrix as a matrix with the lower index as the first index, and the upper index as the second index. So let's write this as N. So given a representation, every basis element of the algebra has an associated matrix by how it acts on the basis vectors, okay, of the basis vectors of the vector space. So now the question I'm going to ask is, what is the representation matrix for the symmetry algebra acting on the basis vector of generators? How does T act, TB act on the basis vectors T? But we've got the answer here. You see? So, this particular representation has a name. It's called the adjoint representation. T adjoint A. Let me put adjoint up. A. The T adjoint B.
Shouldn't A and B flip some indices by the radius of
M? Thank you. Yes, we have A. Now, T adjoint B. Now I need to make sure I'm using the convention that Greenberg uses. By the way, the reference. A real useful reference for today's lecture is chapter 16 in Weinberg's quantum field theory volume 2. Okay, so the chapter when he deals with non-linear gauge theories. Okay. Let me make sure I use his. Minus F A B. By the way, these F's are obviously anti-symmetric in the two lower indices. because the commutator is anti-symmetric in the two indices. Okay, so I can flip the positions of these two lower indices just by changing the sign. Okay, so T is equal to minus FAB. Let's add these. And this is B. Let's see. Minus B.
Is it T of A or T of B?
T of B. TB?
Yes.
Acting on TA?
Yes.
Okay? As A, C, and this is given by minus I, F, A, B, C, D, C. The only thing difficult about this whole game is heap span.
Okay,
sure.
Yes. Previous, like, when you have delta phi, should it be a Bessel parameter?
Bessel. What? Just some small parameter.
I mean, Epsilon A, right?
Okay, yeah, it could be an A. It's true to first order integers. That's it. Right. Okay. Good. Is this clear? Okay, look. What have we got? We had this e to the pi t1 as some element of the group. Now, by acting with the similarity transform within the group, we generated another element of the group. We want to know what is the change in the infinitesimal. And we're working infinitesimal. So we want to know what is the change infinitesimally. What is the change infinitesimally? Okay? In this group element. We found that it was proportional to TB commutator TA. Okay? Now because of that, we have a particular representation of the group, where the group element TB acts on the representation vector TA. You see, now what's confusing about this is that both the role of the symmetry group and the role of the representation vector is being played by the same object, or equivalent objects. Okay? But in our mind, we have to distinguish. So this TB is the generator. This TA is the basis. Is this clear? And we have this identity. Now, in general, the action of TAR, okay? Let me just call this the action of just TA. I'm rubbing on this epsilon. Just confuses this. Okay? It's given by this form. It's for both sides of the multiplied by some epsilon. Okay? So, in general, the action of TAR is given by this. Okay? And so, we identify. Oh, now there's an issue of eyes.
Already, an eye implicit in the calculation on the left.
In what? Sorry?
An eye implicit in the calculation on the left.
It's I T2 comma T1. Comma T1. That's right. You're right. Yeah, so the action of T itself, one way of saying it, is that if I just look at the action of T itself, there would not be an idea in my definition. The symmetric change is e to the pi times T. But the matrix T is just this. Okay, then I'm consistent in my notation, then I won't. No. This times this necessarily has an eye. Why does this have? Why does this have an eye?
Yes, that should also have an eye. Because you have
made
symmetry transformation e power
I t. Well, let's be clear. You're right that the symmetry transformation is e to the pi.
Yes.
This symmetry transformation generates the change I times t on phi. In general. Okay? But now when I define the action of T, I just remove this. Okay? So the there is a matrix T here, okay, whose action on TA, oh, you say it does have the adjustment. Maybe it has. Just let me get the answer. Okay, let me do this. Let me do this really carefully. So first, let's change the. Let's actually find the change in T. So suppose I add here TB and here TA and TB. Okay, so wherever I see 2, it's a B. Okay, so now let me see what the change in this object is. So what I get here is ITA and I'm sending these epsilons. Let's set the epsilons to 1. So you get ITA times I squared into TB cognitive. Okay? So, this whole thing we want to write as I times T something. Okay? So, that tells us that so let's write this as I times T plus I TB. Okay, good. So this tells us that TB commutate at TA had better be a linear combination of T's with an additional I. Okay? So for it to work, it better be the TB commutate at TA is something of this form with an I. Okay, correct. And now, and now sorry about right? Because I'm writing, you see,
So the last thing is delta TA is equal to vector VCTC. So if an I is there, then it's back.
So the last line here?
Yeah, it is like delta TA is equal to vector VCTC.
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Mangesh. Yeah, Mangesh, that's beautiful. Right? So this delta TA is F.
ABC.
Okay, and then we compare with this formula.
Yes.
Sorry, both of you right. Delta phi is equal to I T R A. And then we get the additional minus I. Okay, thank you. Sorry for the confusion. This was just a minute. Is this clear? Okay, so the adjoint action of B is defined by this matrix TB adjoint AC is equal to this one. Right. Now, you see, now what I'm going to do is to understand implication. Why am I writing this? You see, delta. You see, delta T. Okay. See, we've got the space of generators. One particular generator on it. Okay. So, suppose I've got a vector of possible generators. T1, T2, T3. Okay? So TA is a basis vector in the space of generators. Okay? Now how do we write these, the action of a symmetry? We write that acting on a particular basis vector, we get MN phi N. What we want to do is identify this matrix. This matrix, you know, in the matrix we don't write the phi itself. Okay? So what we got here was that delta T was equal to minus I F A B C T C. So this T C here is playing the role of this phi. Okay? So the matrix here just has this. Is this here? Okay. Okay, great. Fine. So we've got this object here. And we have this abstract way of thinking that seems to guarantee that this action will give us a representation of the world. Okay? But of course it's not satisfying until we check this ourselves. You know, check it by hand. Does this action actually give us a representation of the world? What do we have to check in order to check that it gives us a representation of the group? What we have to check is that TB, adjoint, commutator TC, does indeed satisfy the group algebra. Okay? So is indeed FBC A, T adjoint, no, this has no way. This was just a definition of the structure. Okay? So with this definition, that identity should be true. But now we can just plug in what this is here. Okay? We can just plug in what this is here. So it's some bilinear identity, some identity of bilinear quantities in the Fs. Now you can ask, where from can I get some identity in bilinear quantities from the Fs? And of course, all of you know this, it comes from the Jacobi identity. Okay? Suppose I take T A T T commutator T C. Sorry. Okay, I'll just cyclically sum this. The first object is F A B C, F A B D times T D. And then the second commutator gives F D. Okay, so it's a bilinear expressions in the Fs cyclically sums, so the three of them. If you plug this into here, every term is a bilinear expression in the Fs because each T is an F. So this is T times T minus T times T plus F times T. Every term is a bilinear expression in the Fs. Okay, and I won't try to do it on the board because it'll take me 15 minutes and I'll get the signs wrong. But I'll request you to check that this expression is precisely the Jacobi identity you get from this. Okay? So, the fact that on general grounds the group itself generates a representation of its own algebra is borne out on algebraic grounds. Okay? By the Jacobi identity. And the action of the group on itself in the so-called adjoint representation, the action of the group on itself in the so-called adjoint representation is generated by the adjoint matrices, objects here. This is how the group acts on its own generators. Okay. Now, all this is very abstract. Let's look at one familiar example. Familiar example is that of SO3. Okay. SO3 is generated by angular momenta. Okay? Now, angular momenta are by themselves vectors. Okay? So the action of angular momenta on the generators is the adjoint action of SO3. Okay? And so in this case, the adjoint action. Okay? The adjoint action is the action, the adjoint action is simply the spin 1 vector the vector representation of x of 3. Okay? This is a very abstract way that works in general for any group, but for a simple familiar group like SO3, in some language you know this thing. Okay, excellent. So this is all the abstract Lie group theory I wanted to do. There's one more thing to do. Let me tell you. One more. Okay. Now, there's one other construct that will be very important for us in producing these non-trivial functions. This construct is that of an invariant tensor. Okay. So, we will sometimes be interested in taking two generators and making a group invariant. That is multiplying by some object, such that the transformation of this whole object under an infinitesimal generator is zero. Okay? Now, now let's try to see if we can find such a group invariant for any representation of the edge. Study this object. Let's study trace of TA. Let's study what happens when we look at trace of TA in the representative. So now I take this object and I act on it with the action. Okay. I act on it with the action of an infinitesimal generator. I know how generators act on peaks. Okay, so what do I get here? So delta of this is under, let's say, PB. Under the action of PB is F.
such should be a minus sign because it's anti-Semitic. Also, the commutator is anti-Semitic in the lower reasons. But maybe you can always say it.
That's right. That's right. Suppose the following was true, that there existed a metric such that if I use that metric to raise all indices of F or to lower all indices of F, then F was not anti-symmetric just in the two bottom indices, but in all three indices. Suppose that was true. Okay? Then this object would, then the trace of this object would be zero. Because under trace now, so now we raise this object, yeah? Okay? We raise this CA with an A here. And we've got TA, TB. And here we've got, we raise this object as well. So we get this object here. Yeah. Now let's say they're all indices are raised. Okay? Then we've got TT minus TT because of the anti-symmetry, because of the assumed anti-symmetry of the F's. So this would be the trace of commutator and therefore would vanish. Is this clear? So suppose it was true that F when raised by G, or it's equivalently F when lowered by G. Okay, so suppose there existed a G. Okay, that such that F when raised or lowered by G, okay, would make this F completely anti-symmetric. Okay, then the trace of this object would be invariant under group action. Okay. Now, this is a fact that I'm not going to try to prove here, but I'm just going to cite about the theory of groups. Okay. The following is true. That, you know, all groups in the world can be divided into compact and non-compact groups. Okay? Compact groups are groups such that the group manifold itself is a compact object. It doesn't go off to infinity. So an example of this is SU2. It's a space of all rotations, which, as you know, is a three-sphere, or the double double. I mean, in other words, SU2 is a three-sphere. Okay? On the other hand, there are non-compact groups, groups where the group manifold itself is non-compact. An example of this is the Lorentz group. But the set of boosts, you know, increases without bound. Okay? The Lorentz group is like SO3, 1. And if you draw it to some sort of group manifold, if you draw it as some sort of group manifold, this group manifold will just if we draw it as some sort of space, this would be more like hyperboloid than a sphere. Okay, so the result I'm going to quote for you is the following. That for every compact Lie group, okay, it is always possible, okay, it is always possible to find a basis, it's always possible to find a metric, such that by raising with this metric, F becomes completely anti-symmetric. Okay? And when you do this, okay, for such groups, it's also always possible to find a basis for the space of Lie algebras such that the metric is just delta F. So GAB is proportional to delta F.
Sorry,
yes?
I've
not told you why they should be. I've just quoted the result. This is a result from mathematics. There is a nice, simple proof of this result in the appendix to Weinberg's book. Okay? I'll ask you to read it. We won't go through the proof here. Okay? So don't worry about trying to understand why this is true. First, make sure you understand what is true. Okay? So this class of symmetry generators is called compact groups, Lie groups for compact groups, okay, for which this statement is always true. Okay, that is always possible to find a metric, and moreover, it's possible by a choice of basis to put this metric into the form delta A. In fact, the more general statement that it's always possible to find such a metric is more generally true. Okay, so it's true not just for compact Lie-Groups. The thing that is special about the compact Lie-Groups is that it's always possible to put it in the form delta A. For the non-compact Lie-Groups, it's always possible to put it in some similar form, but where some of the eigenvalues of this delta are minus. It's always possible to make it, you know, 1, 1, 1, minus 1, for instance. Okay? But for a compact Lie-Group, it's always possible to find such a, you know, find a metric and find a basis in which this becomes identity. Okay? This is the claim. This is a claim that I'm not going to try to establish. Okay? This will be very important for us when we start building our theories. Okay, sorry. That's it for my incompetent foray into the theory of Lie algebras. Let's move on to physics. Any questions or comments on this? Okay. Fine. So now that we've tried to understand these symmetry groups in some way. Now that we've tried to understand these symmetric groups in some way, what we're going back to is the problem that we started out with. Namely, we've got this field phi, and we want to understand how to build a theory of phi that has some that has invariance under a symmetry algebra that's not just V1, coupled to some massless gauge fields. Okay, so now let's imagine that the kinetic term of our theory took this form before we coupled to gauge fields. GAB, phi A, phi B, del mu phi, where G is the same metric that we discussed before. It has to be the same metric that we discussed before in order for this thing to have an invariance. Oh, this would be the same. No, sorry. G. It would be the same metric we discussed before. These were adjoint value fields, but in general, these are any value. It's just some GMN, such that this whole object was invariant under the symmetric transformation of interest. Okay? For instance, if the symmetric transformation is SO3, okay, and these phi were in the vector representation of SO3, then this GMN would just be delta H. So we imagine that there is some action that is invariant under the symmetry algebra, the global symmetry algebra that we were interested in. And now we want to try to promote this action to an action that is invariant under the gauge symmetry algebra. Okay. So now what we want to do is to look at the suppose the transformations were for the global group, as we discussed, e to the power I. Let's call this lambda h phi. Well, lambda, or let's in general say some u. So the finite version. Okay, u times phi. Well, u is some symmetric generator, which does not depend on points in space. Let's suppose that was the situation. Now, we want to know, suppose I take u and make it u of x. Exactly like was the case in the theory of the electromagnetic field. Okay? Suppose I take this u and make it u of x. How do I preserve invariance? So let's see how the important question is what happens to d mu u of x. Okay? So this object here is equal to u of x times d mu y. Plus the second term. Plus d mu u of x times y. Now, we know that this object here was invariant under u being independent of x. Okay? So, under this dmu phi goes to u of x times dmu phi, this would preserve invariance. Because you pull the u of x outside the derivative, it doesn't matter that it's a function of x. Okay? This term, however, is dangerous. And in general, will break the invariance of the action under the symmetric rule. However, what we're going to try to do is to imitate what we did with electrodynamics. We're going to try to generalize this derivative to a covariant derivative, d mu minus I in angular phi. So imagine that we take the action to involve not little d mu, but capital D mu, acting on phi. Okay? Now we want to know how these A fields should transform in order that it cancels this transformation problem, this funny transformation term, in the transformation of the derivative of phi. Okay? And it's sort of clear. Look at this. Suppose A goes to U A U inverse. U inverse of phi minus del mu U of x. Minus del mu U of x. Let me see. Yes, U of x times U inverse. And I. Excellent. So I've got to cancel this and minus I. Yes. Excellent. Suppose we take this to be the transformation property of U. Then you can see that d mu of phi of x goes to d mu minus I times this whole thing, acting on u times phi of x. Okay? Now this d mu, as we've done before, we break it into two terms, one that goes through on the d mu, on the phi, and the one that acts hits the u. Okay? So we get a total of three terms. I mean, we get a total of, actually, four terms. The so what do we get? One term is when this d mu goes over through to the phi. So that's just u times d mu of phi. One term is when we get this object acting on u phi. And you can see that that is simply plus u minus I u times a mu times phi. Because the u inverse here hits the u here. Okay? And then there is the last two terms. The inhomogeneous term from here, and the term where the d mu hits the u. And you can see that they cancel each other. Right? They've been designed to cancel. So this inhomogeneous term hits the u, the u inverse is killed. We got minus I times minus I, so minus sign times d mu of x. So that's minus d mu of x, which is precisely the plus d mu of x, when the derivative hits the u of x. Okay? So under this transformation rule, you can cover the rule that d mu phi of x goes to u of x times d mu phi. Is this clear? Okay. So, if we had a gauge field along with, our matter field, and the gauge field had this transformation law, okay, then, if we had a gauge field along with the matter field and the gauge field had this transformation law, then this kinetic term d mu phi m d mu phi n g m n would be gauge invariant, provided that the original action was gauge invariant and the global transformations. Okay, that's nice, but it's not sufficient to construct a full interacting field theory based on the symmetric group, because full interacting field theory needs a dynamic term, not just for matter fields, but also, and most importantly, for the gauge fields. So what we need is some sort of kinetic term for the gauge fields that's also invariant under our transformation. Okay? Now, since you use it in general,
or is it the opposite of the?
Some of these phi m's could be some of the phi n stuffs. Now, all I've done is to say that this object here.
No, I'm saying that g mu phi, the whole thing matters, because g mu itself undergoes that, because u is in general complex.
Well, u is in general complex. Yes.
But doesn't the metric take care of?
No. It's true. But you see, this is a matter of notation. But you see, suppose you take phi and phi star as the two sets of different fields. Then the generators act on phi star with a minus sign compared to the generators acting on phi. Okay, so that will account for it. When we look at specific theories, we'll
do. So this is like implicit in the notation.
This is implicit in the notation. It's implicit in the statement that this whole action was invariant under global transformations. Okay, so somebody writing it. That's it. None of that. That is wrong. Okay, let's move on. So, now what we want is the analog of what an electromagnetism was, F mu nu. So we want something like that. Okay? And what you might originally think of trying to do is just defining an F mu, which is d mu a nu minus d mu a nu. By the way, notice that this this A here under global symmetric transformations transforms in the adjoint representation of the gauge group under U's that are not functions of X. Transforms in the adjoint representation. This, if you make infinitesimal, would be transformation under the commutator. Okay? So A is live in the Lie algebra of the gauge group. And under global transformations, transform in the adjoint representation of the gauge group. Is this clear? Okay? So, in particular, this transformation rule implies that if we specialize it to u of x's that are not functions of x's, in particular, it implies that A is transformed in the adjoint representation of the gauge group. Okay, so these A mu's can be written as A mu A times A times A. Where A's are some generators in the of the gauge group. What generators? They're the generators that act on the representation appropriate for the matter field. Okay? And then A is just transformed on the global gauge transformations, like adjoint elements of the gauge group.
Why does the fact that under global transformation it can transform such a right? If they can be written like that, you should.
Now, this is some function of x.
Yeah.
Now let's look at it x by x. Or let's look at it, once and for all. Suppose nothing's a function of x. Okay. So then this action is just x by x.
Right.
Okay, so this part of it is the adjoint generator.
Yeah.
Okay, so at each x it should be written.
Can we say that d mu transforms as adjoint representation given in duplication
that's what we get to. Exactly. So now Mangesh's question is, how does D mu transform? Now, exactly as Mangesh said, you see, the transformation law here was that D mu transformed as U D mu U inverse. So that this acting on U times phi would transform like U times D mu of phi. Okay? So this object here has been devised so that this covariant derivative transforms in the adjoint representation.
So the field states would play the role of the F smallest which we had in the original, right?
Yes. Hang on though. But suppose we try the following. Suppose we try now to define a field strength that was just d mu a mu minus d mu a mu. And check if it had some nice gauge transformation property. The answer will be that it does not. But we would like some homogeneous transformation property, somewhat like d mu. Okay? But this does not have a nice transformation. Let's check it. Okay? So under a gauge transformation, this goes to d mu times U A U inverse minus I D mu U U inverse. Minus D mu, so minus antisymmetric. Minus antisymmetric. Okay? Nothing particularly good, A new. Nothing particularly good happens in this expression. See, one good thing that happens is that when I act d mu on this object, that is killed by the anti-symmetrization, because derivatives, d mu d mu, is symmetric. But there are other actions. There's the action of d mu on this guy. And then there are the actions of d mu on this u and this u inverse. Okay? And of course the action of d mu and a mu is what we want. So that's like the homogeneous term. But there are three other objects. Derivative acting on this guy, derivative acting on this guy, derivative acting on this guy. And you can try your best to fool around with it, but you see that nothing particularly nice happens in this transformation. So this attempt of trying to construct a field strength just by the simple generalization of the U1 construction doesn't work. However, we don't need to try and guess to generalize it to something that works, because we've implicitly already found the answer from Mangesh's observation that the operator d mu acting on any object already transforms into this. Now, since d mu transforms in an isomorph, the correct way to generalize the U1 thinking goes as follows. See, suppose I had d mu minus I a mu. Let's go back to the U1 case. Suppose I had d mu minus I a mu acting on a field phi. And then I acted on it first by d mu, and then d. So suppose I act with it, and suppose I act with d mu minus I a mu times d mu minus I a mu minus the other way around. Minus d mu minus I a mu times d mu minus I a mu. Let's check what I get when I do this. Just check algebraically. Okay. So, there are two terms that obviously give us zero. There's d mu, d mu acting on phi. That's zero because it's electric. So this gives this. And there's a mu acting on phi. That's also zero because in the U1 case, just two numbers, it doesn't matter what order they're in. Okay, so of the four terms here and four terms here, two of them cancel. Two of these cancel with two of these. What remains is the cross terms. Okay, we don't have all derivatives acting on phi, and you don't have no derivatives acting on phi. Okay, so what remains is the term in which and then you can also look at terms when you have two derivatives acting on phi. Those also give you zero. Can you see that? You can have a mu times del mu. And it appears with the same sign, but a minus because of here, with a mu. Alright, let's work that. Okay, suppose I look at all the terms with one derivative acting on phi. Okay, we get here minus I a mu del mu, and here minus the same minus I plus a mu del mu. Okay, and then clearly the same thing from this side. This is symmetric, so this cancels that. So what are the terms that have cancelled? Any term which has both derivatives acting on phi cancels. Okay, any term that has these two a's with no derivatives taken anywhere, that cancels. So what's left? What's left are the terms with one derivative acting on with one derivative at one a, and the derivative acting on a. Okay, those are the only terms that are left. Okay. Yeah, I'm dealing with the U1 case. Okay, so those are the only terms that are left. You see, two derivatives acting on phi, we checked, cancels. One derivative acting on phi, we checked, cancels. So the only term that's left is phi itself, no derivative left. Okay, if the derivatives don't act on phi, then what could happen? Okay, it must be that this derivative acts on the A, and this derivative acts on the A. That's the only remaining term that's left. And you can see that that is proportional to. That is proportional to FPU. So, another way of thinking of the field strength in the U1 theory is as the commutator of two covariant derivatives acting on a field. It's a wonderful fact that the commutator of two covariant derivatives acting on a field is simply proportional to the field strength acting on that field. Okay? So, since we have a nice covariant derivative in the non-abelian theory, since we have a nice covariant derivative in the non-abelian theory, that is the way we're going to generalize our field strength, by generalizing this identity. Okay? So what we're going to do is to say the following. We're going to say, given this covariant derivative, which was d mu minus I a mu, okay, we're going to define our field strength by the following identity. D mu minus I a mu times the commutator of d mu minus I a mu. Acting on some field phi, it's going to by definition be f mu mu acting on that field. Now, for this definition to make sense, it must first be that all terms with both derivatives acting on phi, or terms with one derivative acting on phi, on the left-hand side of that object, vanish. But the check of that is exactly the same as what we did here. The algebraic check that we did for these terms vanishing in the U1 case also works in this case. Okay? So this definition is sensitive. So firstly, it's sensitive. Secondly, it's guaranteed to give us an object that transforms in the directory. Because we know that each of these transform under gauge transformations like U, D, U inverse. So product of these transforms like U, D, U inverse, because U, D, U inverse, that's U, D, U inverse. These two cancel. So the whole thing transforms like a U, D, U inverse. Okay? So this definition is guaranteed to give us a definition such that under gauge transformation, F mu nu goes to U, F mu nu inverse. the right way to generalize the notion of the field strength to the non-abelian. Now, all that remains is to work out algebraically what we get. Okay? At first you might think we're going to run into contradiction because all we're going to get is what we got in the U1 case. But that's not true. It is true we get the terms we got in the U1 case. Okay? It is true that we get the terms that we got in the U1 case. I think I will
Yeah, please.
I think I need a minus I. That the commutator No. Let's look at the logic again. What I wanted to do is to find a notion of the field strength in the abelian theory. A definition of the field strength that would nicely generalize to the non-abelian. Okay? One definition was d mu angle minus d mu angle. That was a nice notion, but it didn't nicely generalize. So we looked for a slightly better notion. So we found a more sophisticated notion of the field strength in the abelian theory. We found that in the abelian theory it was true that d mu commutator of d mu was the field, was the abelian field strength. And then we said, well, this is a definition, this is a notion that will nicely generalize. Because the covariant derivative in the non-abelian theory has by construction been something that that transforms nicely under each other. So if we generalize this definition, then that's guaranteed to give us a field strength that will transform homogeneously. In fact, in the adjoint representation of the gauge group. Is this clear? Okay? Excellent. So this is our definition of the field strength. This object, F. Okay. And now to complete our construction, of a field theory based on this non-abelian gauge group, what we do is very simple. We simply look at F mu nu, let's say A, F mu nu B, GAB, where G was this invariant metric that we invented on the space of generators. And add that with the usual minus whatevers. So let's call this H, some other invariant coordinates. Okay, now we put a minus here. Here we had a minus also. Yes?
So you're...
Oh, please. I'm sorry. I'll very briefly stop. Okay? This now gives us an action that has the following properties. It's invariant under gauge transformations. Okay? And it has a kinetic term for all fields. Okay. So after this...
GAB written here is the, strictly the adjoint.
This is strictly here. These are adjoint indices. Because we know that the gauge fields, and in particular field strengths, transform in the adjoint representation. Okay, so any field strength F can be written as F mu nu A times TA. Okay? And you're right, in the adjoint representation. Okay? And F nu A, these are just generators of gauge. So F nu A times TA, actually any of it doesn't matter.
This is not specific to the adjoint representation.
What?
This is not specific to
the this object here, F mu nu, can be written as F mu nu A times TA.
It's really because both A and commutator A can be written in actually.
Right. And now the action will be generated by commutation in the gauge group. The action of transformations will be generated by how you want to know how does the infinitesimal generator TB act on this object? It acts on F by TB commutator with F. To say this, I don't need to say what representation this TA is present. Okay? So, written this way, I have not chosen, you know, this is just the coefficients of elements in the adjoint representation. So let me say that again. Any object that is in the adjoint representation is by definition alpha A times TA. That statement puts it in the adjoint representation. Puts the alphas, the space of alphas, in the adjoint representation. I don't need to say any more about what representation those TAs happen to be. Is this clear? Okay, written this way, there's no TA. Yeah, these A's are just indices that are, you know, that tell you about the transformation properties under this table. Is this clear?
You mean TA square be the generators of what A's?
What?
What A?
Could be these could be generators. These are generators of this group, yeah. But could be in any representation for this table.
Suppose it's the fundamental.
It could be the fundamental representation, it could be the adjoint representation, it could be in any representation.
And then necessarily this is the...
You see, these Fs,
yeah.
FAs are defined to be the coefficients of TA in the expansion F is equal to FA times TA. And then I don't need to say what representation. You see, because the action of F is commutator by TB in whatever representation you write FA. Or to say it another way, this is now an abstract group theory statement. F is equal to FA TA, where TA is the generator of the group. And the action of the group on this is in the adjoint representation, by combination. Okay, because it acts like U, F, U. I don't need to say any more. This is an abstract, this could be just an abstract group theory. Is this clear?
But since F mu mu over here has been built out of the derivatives of A mu mu's and A mu mu's themselves, which are, they transform under the adjoint representation.
No, wait. These A mu's here,
yes.
Acting on any particular matter field,
yeah.
Had this expression T A mu A T A,
yes.
Where T A is for the representations in that for that matter field. But you see, we could have a theory with three different matter fields transforming three different representations. So if we were constrained to build a kinetic term for the gauge field based on the representation in which the matter appears, we'd be in trouble. Okay? We would not be able to write such a theory. But we're not constrained. You understand? This is a very important point. The gauge field itself transforms in the adjoint representation, independent of what the matter is. Okay? Therefore, the gauge field can be written as, the field strength can be written as FAT. Now, the FAs then have certain transformation by commutator with TB. And this transformation property is independent of what representations the TA is put in. It's a very important point. So the gauge fields transform in the adjoint representation. Therefore, gauge fields can be written as FA times TA, where that TA is in absolutely any representation. Is this clear? Okay? I'll very quickly now come to the... So where were we? So where we were was that now we've got some sort of non-abelian gauge theory, a non-abelian action, okay? That we can use as a basis for some part of the integral quantization. Okay? So what is our action? So what is our part of the integral? S is equal to dA mu. And by the way, now that we've got this theory, we can look at it even in the absence of. Just like we could study electromagnetism in the absence of matter fields. No, we use matter fields as a motivation to build up this theory, but it exists by itself in the absence of matter fields. So let's write this as exponential of I times minus x mu mu s d mu nu. Okay, I'll put this A, B, B, A, B. And then we keep putting by 4. Actually, we usually use another dimension, but let's put by 4. And just let me look at the pure deviance. Okay, now let's turn to our path integral. And once again, try for an inverse space interpretation of this path integral obtained by slicing. Yeah. So we're going to do the same thing as this. We're going to do basically, exactly the same thing as this. Okay. But there are two interesting twists to what happens in the universe. The first twist goes as follows. There's this metric GAB. Okay. Now, you remember I told you that for compact gauge groups, it was possible always to diagonalize, to make GAB problem. For any gauge groups, possible to make GAB a diagonal matrix with ones or minus ones. But for compact gauge groups, it's possible to make it with just ones. Okay? Now, what happens when you make it with just ones? What it means is that all kinetic terms have the correct sign. Okay? All terms have A, I dot A the whole thing square. With a plus. However, if this GAB has some negative signs, then for those Bs, we will get the wrong sign kinetic term. Now, this is exactly the kind of thing that we discussed in the last class. It's not good. Again, it leads to unbounded energies from below. It leads to problems with unitarity. Okay? So, this whole trick of generalizing to the study of non-abelian gauge theories only works when we are able to find a metric of the space of ABs that is positive definite. It's positive definite. And as we discussed before, that only works for compact groups. Okay? So, though for formal purposes it's sometimes useful to study gauge theories based upon compact groups, unless you do something sophisticated or you don't think, if you don't think too much, certainly for straightforward applications, we should restrict our attention to gauge theories based on compact groups. That's the first thing. Now, the second thing is more simple, but Okay, so let me now imagine that I'm working with a compact group and that I'm working in a basis such that GAB is proportional to delta AB. Okay? And I'll even omit this from my notation. Okay? F square means F mu nu A, F mu nu A, everything contracted. Okay, I'll just omit that notation. Just to make lighten up the notation. Okay, fine. Now, what about the next? The next thing is the Hilbert space interpretation of this part. Okay, so we want to imitate our discussion of the abelian theory. Okay, so in the imitation to our discussion of the abelian theory, what do we find? We find that the Hilbert space interpretation is given by the following hybrid object. The Hilbert space interpretation is given by path integral over A0. This is A0A for all these. Times e to the power minus I ht. What is h? H is a Hamiltonian that acts on Hilbert space. That is made out of functionals, square integrable functionals, of AAI for all A's, for all I's. Okay? But what is H more particularly? H more particularly, as before, is given by canonical factorization. Okay? So more particularly, what is this object? Well, let's first write out the Lagrangian. The Lagrangian is F0i sum over A implicit. The whole thing squared by 2 minus Fij, whole thing squared by 5. The whole thing by 4. No change here from the negative. You'll just write it in terms of ifs. Okay? And then, what is the canonical momentum with respect to A0iA? If A index. So, canonical momentum is simply F is simply F 0 I as before with no momentum. Okay, so the Hamiltonian as before is equal to A I dot F 0 I minus the Lagrangian. As before, what we're going to do is write this in terms of the canonical moment. The canonical moment was F0i. Okay? Now, what was F0i? F0i was del 0 ai minus del I a0 minus I a0 commutator n. Is this clear? This was our definition of the case.
Now we have written it in terms of standard data, just right. So now
everything has an A.
Right. So it's FABC.
Thank you. So this was, now the only question is it plus or minus? Yes, so if we wrote it in terms of matrices, it would be this. I just have to pull out the coefficient of, cheated, right? So it was del mu a mu minus del mu a mu minus I a mu a mu. Then we substitute in this. A mu is equal to a mu a t a. And then we use the commutation relations. So this guy, these are all proportional to TA. This guy now is here. Suppose I had TB, TC. So this would be A mu B, A mu C. And then this is TB, TC, F, B, C, A, A. Okay.
Yeah,
with an I minus I cancel, so plus. Okay, so let's put A here. Plus F B C A times A 0 B A I's. Okay, thank you. Okay, now what we want to do is to write this object as this plus this minus it. Okay? So, once we do that, this F0i will combine with the F0i in the Hamiltonian. So our full Hamiltonian here will be F0i squared by 2 plus Fij by 4. Okay? And then we will have, we've added and then subtracted this object, so plus del I A0a minus FBCA A0b A A I C. okay, times f0 y. Is this clear? Okay. Now when we make a Hilbert space interpretation, what do we get? You see, now the integral over a0, a are these action wave functions. Okay? This is the generator of shifts in AI. So all this does is shift AI by this quantity and integrate over that. Okay? So, what this does is take psi of AI, A, and then add that quantity to it. Plus del I A 0 A minus F B C A A 0 B A I C.
So this will just be like a shift in the, like when we do a Gaussian integral, for example, like we do just do a shift, like change of variables to get back the.
Wait, this is not a change of variable. It's like the projection. But we have to identify what this projection is. Okay? Now, this, you can check, is simply AIA times plus di of a0, with the covariant derivative acting in the adjoint representation. But this is precisely the action of an infinitesimal gauge transformation on the AI fields. How do you know that? Well, we know how AI transform under finite gauge transformations. Okay? We know how AI transforms under finite gauge transformations. Okay? All you have to do is to take that finite action and specialize it to the infinitesimal case. And you'll find this. Okay? So, once again, the Hilbert space interpretation of this problem is very simple. Okay? Once again, the Hilbert space interpretation of the problem is a very simple one. It's projecting the wave function onto the gauge invariant sector. Is projecting the wave function onto the gauge invariant sector. Okay? My gauge invariance is now defined by gauge invariance. The correct gauge invariance for the non-linear. Is this clear? Any questions or comments on this? I'll let you go 3-4 minutes. Any questions or comments about this? Okay. Now, in the last three, four minutes of today's class, we discussed let me say it anyway. Talk about it again next class. We discussed an issue concerning these path integrals. These path integrals. Involving the abelian, non-abelian gauge theories. An issue concerning them that came up last class, and I think you were uncomfortable about the infinite volume of the gauge group. Jump. Sorry, do you have something going on here? No? No. Great. So in the last bit of today's class, or maybe it's I want to discuss the Fadi Popov procedure. Let me do it. It's 2 minutes. Okay. Right. So, see the problem with this. Yeah. Okay. So we've got this gauge, this path integral. It's perfectly well defined. Actually, forget it. Let's do the next one. Okay. So let's see. So where are we? So what we've done is very briefly survey the three basic kinds of path integrals we'll encounter in this course. Path integrals of scalar fields, path integrals of gauge fields, abelian as well as non-abelian. Okay, and path integrals over Fermi-Yuki fields. Okay, I have a problem set for you by next Friday. Give you some basic manipulations with non-abelian gauge theories and so on to try to work out. Okay. Also with some fermionic integrals. Okay. So we've spelled out the basic grammar of what's going to happen in the class. We need to do a little more formal analysis of the gauge theories. I want to discuss this Fadi Popov method to make perturbative calculations possible using path integrals in gauge theories, and also BRST quantization, the BRST Hamiltonian interpretation of gauge theory path integral. After we go through that, we start actually doing more. I mean, start using this for physics. We start doing more physics stuff. Say for that. Okay. Thank you. Any questions or comments?
Do we have a class this Friday?
Oh yes, this Friday is Independence Day. No, can't we be arrested for doing that? No, not arrested. What is your schedule? If we need makeup classes, when can you?
Thursday. We have it
in the evening. Or afternoon.
What? Afternoons, evenings, you're totally free?
Yeah.
What about Tuesday afternoon?
Tuesday, Thursday
afternoon. What about Wednesday afternoon? What about Wednesday, 2 o'clock? I'll have to check availability of this classroom. What we need is a mailing list for this course. Could somebody take charge of making a mailing? Who knows? All of you are in the student room, more or less. Who's not in the theory student room here? Who here does not sit? Okay. There's one person. So somebody who sits in the theory student room, can you create a mailing list? Mangesh, can you create a mailing list in this class? Okay. So just so that if we have to change something, it's easy to send out messages. Okay. Excellent.
So this Wednesday will be in class?
No, no, not this Wednesday. Next class. We could try class this Wednesday. What is your situation this Wednesday? This Wednesday at 2 o'clock, you say, fine. I'll have to confirm availability, but Wednesday noon is 4. Yeah. I just have to check various things. That is the seminar of any sort and so on. Provided, then we'll try to. Thank you.